Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for the warm welcome. Since I've been working in Passau, I have two places where I live, because Passau and Frankfurt, it's a 4 hours train ride. And when I introduce myself, usually I say I tend to work in bed, which always causes a huge laugh on people. And so I have two beds. In one bed I work on Mark's gospel, and on the other bed I'm cheating Mark with Luke. So if I ever start to work on Matthew or John, I will need a third place to live. the plan is today that I will be speaking for roughly 45 to 50 minutes, depending on how nervous I am. If you have the impression I'm talking way too fast, please raise your hands. So another Jesus remembered, how the third gospel narrates Jesus. It has been widely acknowledged in biblical scholarship that the third gospel presents a different Jesus than the gospels according to Mark, Matthew, and John. With the latest paradigm shift in Jesus research, one might also say that it presents another Jesus remembered. Before I engage in an exemplary memory-sensitive reading of the third gospel today, let me briefly introduce my own approach and thereby also explain the difference between this approach and Redaktionskritik, and what, according to my own experience, memory theory can and cannot do and cannot add to Jesus and gospel research. The reflections presented here are part of a larger project seeking to provide a theoretical and hermeneutical basis and develop methods to reading the New Testament and early Christian texts as memory texts. In my Habilitationsschrift, Marcus Collective Memory, I delivered a hermeneutical framework for this enterprise, drawing from the work of Maurice Halbwachs, Aleida, and Jan Assmann, German socialist Harald Welzer, and others. This hermeneutical work concluded in a matrix that allows reading texts either as social, collective, or cultural memory before applying the theoretical findings to the Gospel of Mark in a second part. One insight gained in the discussion about the project and the question how New Testament and early Christian texts can be read as memory literature was that while narrating the past or memories of events and encounters with Jesus and his proclamation, New Testament texts provide frames for identity construction, both for those who stand behind these texts and those who read them. When I give talks and deliver papers about the contribution of social memory theory to Jesus and gospel studies, a typical critical statement is that this is neither new nor does add anything to other approaches. A very blunt statement at the German Bultmann-Tagung was once, "You are taking Redaktionskritik away from us. What do you have to offer instead?" I will try to give a brief answer here, knowing that this question would require a much more detailed answer. Let me begin with a few general statements about the approach. Social memory theory and cultural memory studies, as would be the equivalent in the German discourse, is an inter- and transdisciplinary effort to investigate, understand, and describe the processes of recollection, memory, and forgetting, both of individuals and groups. One important aspect is the relation between memory and identity. That is what we are usually dealing with in biblical studies when we study foundational texts. Interdisciplinary research on memory is not very optimistic about the reliability of human memory, thus social memory theory is not about finding out what happened. It is neither claiming that collective memory texts are composed of reliable memories about what happened or not, nor providing a toolkit for explaining how individual and collective memories have been distorted in the process of remembering and recalling. In sum, social memory theory is likewise pessimistic when it comes to the quest for earlier stages of traditional material or regaining otherwise lost sources. Quite the contrary, taking into account research on the processes of memorization and recalling, as well as the processes of reorganizing the material, an honest assessment of social memory theory in biblical studies has to state that this kind of search is pointless, and certain questions of historical Jesus research must be regarded as insolvable and thus more or less futile. Even more important, social memory theory is not interested in these questions. Although providing a basic model of the processes of memorization and recalling both for individuals and groups, their circumstances and drawbacks, social memory theory alone cannot provide a model for the growth of, for instance, the Gospels. It can only serve as a heuristic to see texts of groups like early Jesus followers as what they are, externalizations of collective memories that are always influenced by the context and the identity construction of those who remember them. A memory-sensitive reading takes these texts as artifacts of the Wirklichkeitskonstruktion, reality construction, of those who have verbalized and textualized them. It is this reality construction they investigate with approved methods used for analyzing texts in the different academic disciplines. Social memory theory is not a method, but a hermeneutics for a hopefully better understanding of the texts we're dealing with. Social memory theory acknowledges that memory texts, just like other founding or canonical texts, neither go without a purpose nor a community. Seemingly looking backwards in narrating the past, their actual focus is the present, and they're making distinct statements about the recent stage and what the future should look like. Memory texts are not looking backwards, but forward. They're remembering the present for the future. No, they're remembering for the present and the future. Social memory theory is less interested in the status quo ante than it is interested in the status quo. The question of Luke's gospel would thus not be what has happened, but who is Jesus for us and what does it mean and look like to be Christian, which is basing your identity on the Christ event. Remembering Jesus does thus not say who Jesus was, but who Jesus is for the group behind the text and what building a community on this conviction means. Read as externalization of collective memory, Luke's gospel would, rather than giving historical data or a report of Jesus' life, provide a framework for early Christian identity constructions. Even if read as a piece of historiography, it would be narrating the past from a certain point of view, providing a particular orientation in the present. From a social memory point of view, there is little difference between senatorial historiography remembering the Roman emperor or a gospel remembering Jesus. A memory-sensitive reading is neither about finding out what has really happened, nor the growth of the text, but about analyzing the structure and pragmatics of the Jesus memories presented in a particular text. It shares with Redaktionsgeschichte that there is no way behind the text to the events. It differs from Redaktionsgeschichte in its pessimism that prior stages of traditions in an existing text could be regained, especially if all of these sources are thought to be written and stable. Memory theory is fully aware of the characteristics of orality, second orality, and the question of fluidity of texts, taking these factors into account when reading memory texts. Other than a redaktionsgeschichtliche Interpretation, its result will neither be a description of the redactional patterns of the text nor a determination of its sources, but reading the text as a product of its own time, a piece of narrative identity construction. The question is not why the text is organized in a particular way, but what the impact is of a text organized exactly that way. And to my knowledge, Redaktionsgeschichte does not address this question. While Redaktionsgeschichte tends to be looking into the past, memory-sensitive readings regard the present. They take the fact that memory texts and founding stories are always about a group's identity much more serious than the quest for a text's Sitz im Leben ever did. Social memory theory is not about whether memories are reliable or not, but about the meaning and the impact of a memory story told in a certain way. The goal is finding out what suggestions for identity construction the text holds, in how far it is, to speak with Jan Assmann, identity concrete. The third gospel thus says less about the historical Jesus than the presentation of Jesus' memory speaks volumes about the time and the issues of those who remember him this way. Reading Luke as a memory text, we will just start at the beginning. The proemium in Luke 1, 1-4, and the same holds true for Acts 1, 1-4, is not only the most obvious occasion of direct reader communication in the text, but also shows how the text works as an identity-founding story. The addressee of the text is a certain Theophilos. The question whether the name applies to real person, for instance a benefactor, or is a placeholder for any friend of God who can find himself being addressed, has been discussed for centuries. No matter how the question is answered, whether the addressee is figurative or a real person, the honorary address Krateste Theophile depicts a person of some social or political prominence, at least a considerable social standing. Beyond that, Theophilos is attributed to be katechete, means that he has been informed or taught in the Logos. The reader communication establishes that the text is directed to someone familiar with Christian faith and teaching. The assumption impacts the estimated pragmatics of the text. Read this way, the idea behind the gospel is neither apologia nor mission, but assertion. Theophilos is confirmed of the reliability, safety, or even truth of the teaching, and thus the identity he has been trained in and which he seeks to practice in his own life. Shall we wait for these people to come in? Recent research on the proemium supports this notion. In his article called Luke as Tradent and Hermeneut, David Mössner suggests, on the basis of a thorough investigation of the verb par ecoluteo, that the notoriously difficult par ecolutecote 1-3, quote, placards one trained in a tradition and not the judicious laborers of historians' research, quote end. Though he does not engage with the memory theory, Mössner's translation indicates to the memory theory worst recipient that Luke's gospel is thought to be an identity formative text. His suggestion for translation of 1-1-4 is, since many have undertaken to compile a narrative concerning the events matters which have been fulfilled in our midst, just as those from the beginning eyewitnesses and attendants of the word delivered to us, it seemed good to me also to write in a sequence as one who has a thorough informed familiarity with these events matters from the top, that you may gain a firm grasp of the significance of the events matters which you have been taught. This reading abandons all notions to Luke the historian and portrays him as one who has not been with the way, as he calls the movement in Acts, from the very beginning, but received a thorough training in the tradition of the group himself, so that he is capable of passing on tradition to others and foster what they have carved out as a Christian identity. When telling the foundational story of early Jesus followers, the third gospel does not jump into narrating how people encounter Jesus and become his disciples. Before any of these encounters is narrated, the text takes a considerable amount of time, four full chapters, to introduce the protagonist and establish his identity. Jesus is, so to say, only allowed to start his ministry once the reader is fully instructed how to understand the story. Chapters 3 and 4 of Luke's Gospel are a good example for a memory-sensitive reading. During his baptism, the Spirit descends on Jesus and is introduced as the reason why Jesus is not only able, but actually driven to do what he does. The cultural pattern according to which this is narrated, directly pointed out twice in the text, comes from the prophet Isaiah. Jesus is Christos, with God's Spirit, and the one to console and exhort his people. It is only after the narrative voice has confirmed that Jesus is indeed God's anointed one in 441 that the story of Jesus and those who will follow him actually begins. When later asked whom they consider Jesus to be, Peter will confirm what the reader, thanks to the descent of the Spirit during the baptism, Jesus' own perception of Isaiah 61:1, and the narrator's insight into the numinous character's knowledge is already assured of. Jesus is God's anointed one, ton Christon to Theou, 9:20. Only after this is established, the scope can be broadened, still following Isaiah's path. God's anointed one, the reader and the disciples learn, needs to suffer, just like Isaiah's servant. The particular shape of the suffering is determined by the historical events, its rational and pattern of understanding delivered by recourse to Israel's scripture, or the socio-religious and cultural framework of the early Jesus followers. And this can only be applied in hindsight, as the closing chapter of the Gospel proves, and I will return to that later. To put it differently, only Jesus followers with a certain perspective will receive Jesus as God's anointed one and shape their lives accordingly. The way Luke tells the story, Peter has his decisive encounter with Jesus only after the readers have understood who Jesus is and can thus relate to what is told. While the readers might wonder in Mark's and Matthew's version of the story why the first disciples follow a stranger who appeared seemingly out of nowhere and comes up with strange promises like fishing men, in the Lucan version, the first disciple reacts to an encounter and an experience with Jesus and responds to an insight he has gained when encountering Jesus. After this, nothing is the same, and only then he is willing and able to change his life. Luke's Gospel recalls a series of these life-changing encounters. In the face of Jesus, many of the characters realize who they are, and they do not only need to, but want to change. The crucial moment of insight is at times narrated as a miracle, as it is the case with Peter. The underlying experience is that the encounter with Jesus changes people and their lives. These changes come about mainly through listening to Jesus and the experiences of being healed one way or the other. Let's take a closer look. How does Luke present people's encounters with Jesus, and how does he present Jesus himself? Luke locates his Jesus story mostly in an urban environment. It's less the rural Palestinian world of Jesus than the Roman Empire, Roman culture, and society in larger Hellenistic cities that he introduces his readers to. Where Mark speaks about villages and rural regions, Luke has townspeople crowding together and listen to the parable of the sower or gather intelligence about the proper way to listen and to be attentive. Luke has Jesus not only move from village to village, but also from town to town. The 70 or 72 disciples in 10:1-12 are not sent into villages, but into towns. The subsequent woos also address unrepentant cities, Chorazin and Bethsaida, and compare them to other cities, Tyrus and Sidon. The crucial point might be less the size of the places referred to, but the fact that Luke uses the term polis, and by this use of the expression creates a certain impression or invokes a certain concept. Sending out the 12 in 9:5, Jesus has already used polis, while the narrator says that the disciples, di archonto katatos komas, referring to somewhat smaller places. Incidents and characteristics of seemingly minor significance, like the size of the places Jesus visits, on the whole create a different image of Jesus in Luke than a reader coming from Mark would be familiar with. Let us look briefly at a few other points. Luke's Gospel introduces Jesus as one who cares for poor and needy people, but neither depicts a poor Jesus, nor one who actively turns to and engages with the poor. Luke's Jesus is able to read, behaves like someone with scribal training, and is capable of arguing with scripture. This notion is already invoked in the childhood story in the temple, chapter 2, when Jesus sits in the midst of the teachers, listens, and asks questions. The image is almost immediately taken up when the actual narrative about Jesus begins in the fourth chapter. The temptation presents a Jesus well-versed in the Torah, and the scene in the synagogue of Nazareth introduces a Jesus whose custom it is to attend synagogue service and play an active part by means of reading from the scripture and preaching. The sacrifice offered on Mary's purification in the temple, again chapter 2, consists of a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. The choice of the animals is habitually understood to be a sign of poverty, in recourse to the regulations of the book of Leviticus, chapter 12. Recent findings in biblical scholarship challenge that consensus, claiming that the choice of animal rather reflects the reality of sacrifice customs in Jesus' days than the social state of those who offer them. Wolfgang Zwickel has provided a convincing calculation. The size of the altar would not have been able to manage the sheer amount of sacrifices. The sacrifices due every day, 2 lambs of 1 year's age, and the additional sacrifice for the benefit of the emperor, 2 lambs and a bull, according to Philo, would have been manageable, but the extra sacrifices for the holidays and private offerings would have easily overstretched the altar's capacity. Thus, for practical rather than for status reasons, the average sacrificial animals are more likely to have been birds than large animals like sheep and cattle. So no poor Jesus here either. Jesus' family, too, undergoes some changes from Mark to Luke. Luke abandons the son of the carpenter and instead narrates that Jesus' parents go to Jerusalem for Pascha every year. This does not only make them particularly pious and observant Jews, but also indicates a certain economic situation. Even traveling to Jerusalem on foot has its price. It is not only the journey from Nazareth to Jerusalem and the duration of the stay itself, but also the suspension of earnings during the absence that has to be considered and compensated, and not everyone was able to afford that. Taken together and read as a whole against the background of Mark and even Matthew, it seems that the Lucan Jesus is better off than his synoptic brothers. Similar to the Paul of Acts, who can be assigned to a higher stratum than the Paul of his own letters, Jesus appears to be richer than he might have actually been. The same reason might apply for both cases. It's easier to identify with someone alike and familiar than with someone who comes or seems to come from another world. To risk a bold thesis, Luke might have needed a Jesus from a higher stratum than the one he found in Mark or other traditions to reach his audience represented by Theophilus. The Lucan Jesus is much more of a Roman Hellenistic townsperson than the Markan one who avoids cities and almost exclusively comes across villages and rural areas, and could thus be received as some kind of Galilean colche. The Lucan Jesus can read, is particularly skilled when it comes to arguing within his religious and cultural frame. He is well versed both in Israel scriptures, Roman Hellenistic manners, and commercial habits. He associates naturally and confidently in exactly those circles his Markan alter ego gave wide berth. In Luke's text, rich, influential, and clearly recognizable Roman townspeople play unique roles. Jesus meets some of these rich and influential people on different occasions, some of them at the meals he is invited to. Other than the Markan Jesus, who is said to sometimes even lack the time to eat, the Lucan Jesus is frequently met at banquets where he is not reclining with the poor and needy. Consequently, the Lucan Jesus is also remembered as an anthropos phagos kai einotopotes, one who is eating and drinking way too much, a label no character in Mark's gospel would possibly dream of applying to Jesus. As Luke is commonly considered to be much more concerned with Gentiles than any other gospel, the question is also, how is it possible to receive God's anointed one as someone who is not a member of God's chosen people? Two questions come to mind. How can Gentiles join the groups of early Jesus followers? And what happens to the Jewish framework and Jewish identity of those groups when a considerable number of non-Jews join the movement? Acts will directly address these issues, but the question is already tangible in Luke. After Jesus is properly introduced and established as God's anointed one at the end of Luke 4, with references to Isaiah so clearly flagged that even those who are not familiar with the text cannot miss them, after calling his first disciples and establishing the inner circle of the 12, the apostles, Jesus delivers his manifesto. The Sermon on the Plain is also similar to Matthew's Sermon on the Mount, distinctly different, not only as regards the absence of direct quotations from Israel scripture, something people would have expected from God's anointed one. Following the story as it unfolds, it becomes even more astonishing. A Gentile character who does not even appear in person is not only pictured to be the exemplary recipient of this sermon, but also by his example shows better than anyone in Israel what pistis, faith or confidence in Jesus really is about. While the disciples keep wondering and will later be asked by Jesus where their pistis actually is. The centurion of Capernaum, 7:1-10, is an interesting character and merits more attention than usually given. Luke is quite cleverly weaving him into the narrative strand. The sermon on the plain ends with a parable about a man building a house who dug deep and laid a foundation upon the rock, depicting this behavior as exemplary reception of Jesus' words. The centurion will a couple of verses later be introduced as the one who has built the synagogue of Capernaum. Both stories make use of the word oikodomeo, which provides a clear link between them. The centurion of Capernaum is not only introduced as a Roman officer, but also a rich Gentile who acted as a patron. Other than in Matthew, where the centurion approaches Jesus himself, Luke is paying much more attention to the categories of honor in a society shaped by patronage relationships and represents the whole scene as a dance of honor between the centurion and Jesus, following a particular choreography. First, the centurion sends a delegation of Jewish elders to the Jew Jesus, and when Jesus accepts to follow the invitation, quickly responds by sending a second delegation of presumably Gentile friends, which is his clientele, to persuade him that entering the centurion's house would be too much of an honor. The honored Jesus is not supposed to come to the less honorable centurion. The first group the centurion sends reflects the role he plays for the local community. And when he heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders asking him to come and save the life of his slave. And when they had come to Jesus, they earnestly entreated him, saying, "He is worthy for you to grant this to him, for he loves our nation, and it was he who built us our synagogue." In Luke's version of the story, the centurion is a lot richer and closer to Jewish religion than in Matthew. He might even be considered a proselyte, in any case, someone who is close enough with the local Jewish elders that he can send them for Jesus. How did the centurion learn about this Jesus, by the way? As he is presented to be the one who built the Capernaum synagogue, he must be assumed to know about what happened there a few chapters early, namely in chapter 4. The crucial point about the centurion is, however, that he arrives at pistis in Jesus through his own cultural framework and verbalizes his realization by using the address kurios for Jesus, which in the third gospel is only used by characters who have come to a deeper understanding of Jesus. From his own experience with mighty words, we would today say performative words, he trusts Jesus up to the point that he asks him to save his servant or even his son. The text is unclear about that. Like his counterimage Jairus, the head of the synagogue, the centurion asks for someone else's life to be saved. In the course of the narrative, the question how to gain eternal life, definite salvation, becomes more and more relevant. The question what one must do to inherit eternal life is asked twice, chapters 10 and 18, and both questioners enjoy authority in the religious community. One is a lawyer, the other one of the rulers. In the first situation, in Luke 10, Jesus answers the questioner by asking another question. What is written in the law? What do you read there? He directs the lawyer's attention to their common cultural frame, insinuating that the answer can be found there. Jesus does not abolish the law. His answer, "Do this and you will live," indicates that there will be no other law or teaching replacing the current one, only explanation and proper application of the existing. This interpretation is reinforced by the following parable of the Samaritan. Jesus narratively unfolds one axiom central to his gospel. You can inherit eternal life by fulfilling the law, but it's necessary to understand the law properly. a message particularly appealing to non-Jews who gradually enter the picture. Fulfilling the letter is no guarantee for inheriting eternal life. The law is not a checklist of individual points that can be fulfilled in isolation from the outside world. Loving God and one's neighbor does not imply that this neighbor has the same ethnic, religious, and cultural background, and in the story along comes a Samaritan who is the next neighbor. The second questioner approaches Jesus with almost the same question: "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" To the reader, the address "teacher" communicates already that he has not understood and will not understand. Jesus also directs this man back to their common cultural frame, this time narrowing it down to the commandments. The man replies that he has kept all of them since his youth. As in the first episode, a second step follows. Jesus takes the questioner further by opening up to him a larger perspective. There is still one thing lacking. Sell all that you own and distribute the money to the poor, and you will have a treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. Again, the follow-up describes exemplary behavior with respect to compassion and the proper handling of property. The issue is once more loving God and one's neighbor. In the second regard, the man has clearly failed. Considering that without his denarii, the Samaritan would not have been able to offer sustainable help, the insight is dawning that property as such is not the problem, but the way one deals with it, a central motive in Luke's gospel. How the ruler will deal with his property will show whether he has understood what the law is really about, not only to love God, but also one's neighbor. Zacchaeus and the rich woman have clearly understood this lesson, and therefore they are not asked to get rid of all their money. It's obviously possible to also love God and your neighbor with your money or through your money. The centurion of Capernaum comes to mind as the first example of such an approach. The ideal depicted in Luke's gospel, the well-off caring for the less well-off, involves money. Compassion and charity do not work without property and material resources. The Christian idea to focus on the poor and needy and help them in order to win eternal life and salvation works only with the appropriate means. Luke's gospel to the rich would thus not be that money, property, and wealth are intrinsically evil and have to be abandoned in one single act before the formerly rich person becomes poor himself, for only the poor are blessed. The message is rather to cultivate community and balance. A patron, like the centurion of Capernaum, who becomes Christian and remains in his social status, is of greater help to his community and clientele than someone who abandons everything and afterwards lines up with the petitioners and almsmen. A first conclusion from a close reading of Luke and some glances into Acts is that Luke Acts scriptures serves as a religious and cultural framework. I've spared you some of the examples I've carved out with regards to time. At a close look, scriptures graphy, especially Torah, Psalms, and Isaiah, are tangible as the underlying structure of Luke's gospel from the beginning in the temple to the end in the temple. This structure is operating at least on two levels. On the one hand, it is the frame Jesus uses for his own teaching, and on the other hand, scripture provides the framework for understanding Jesus himself. The closing chapter of the Gospel, Luke 24, leaves no doubt that Israel's scriptures are the key to understand Jesus. The narrator states, "Then beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures." Luke 24, 27. There are two different ways to read this sentence. Richard Hayes has suggested a reading strategy that takes the crucified and risen Jesus as the hermeneutical key to the, as he says, scripture, singular, of Israel. It's likewise possible to understand the text just the other way around, namely that the scriptures of Israel are the hermeneutical key to properly understand the crucified and risen Jesus. In his Habilitationsschrift, Dietrich Husam examined the Old Testament in Luke, asking whether the scriptures in Luke's Acts serve to stage and interpret Jesus' life, passion, and resurrection. Such a reading works both ways, and Jerusalem assumes Luke might have wanted to indicate to his presumably Gentile contemporaries how Gentile Christians are supposed to read the scriptures of Israel. Luke does not have his characters refer to the scriptures simply to strengthen their argument, but to show their contemporaries how to read the scriptures and maintain this heritage. In other words, Israel's traditions have become textualized, they have become scripture, and this textualized tradition serves as a cultural frame in Luke. Within this frame, ethical, religious, and practical questions are addressed, and Jesus' memories are constructed. The identity of the community is modeled on the basis of Jesus' memories. For the community of commemoration, the scriptures are both a frame of reference and an impulse giver. They're both interpretation and guideline. It is this frame that calls forth and facilitates faith. What Luke narrates can only be adequately understood within this frame. The graphai are not only the necessary social, cultural, and religious framework for understanding Jesus, but also for his early followers. The encounter on the road to Emmaus exactly unfolds that narratively. It is apparent that Cleopas and his companion are struggling to understand Jesus, and that they are trapped in misunderstanding. That is what the unrecognized traveler makes clear to them. They cannot understand Jesus because they do not read him in the cultural frame of Torah and prophets, as this has been done by the narrator in chapters 3 to 4. This reading can, as we've seen, of course, only happen in hindsight. That's why Jesus has to open the scriptures to them, to use their own words. The scriptures are the frame they need to understand Jesus in a particular way, neither as teacher nor as prophet, definitely not as a political leader, but as Christos, and as the group in Jerusalem will add on their return, as Kyrios. As Acts continues to unfold, for early Jesus followers, there is no other way to perceive Jesus. Only those who understand Jesus as Christos and Kyrios in accordance with the scriptures will inherit life and obtain admission to the early Christian communities. In the course of Acts, this will mean that Gentiles too can join and inherit eternal life. For them, not the fulfillment of the law is crucial, but the adequate understanding of Jesus and his teaching, which are both located in a Jewish framework. Luke's final chapter demonstrates that Jesus can only be properly understood from this perspective of law and prophets. Once he is understood that way, it's no longer necessary to fulfill law and prophets, only to follow the way of the kingdom of God that Jesus has taught. The question about the status of the Jews in the later more and more Gentile Christian groups is thus answered in its own way. In order to properly understand Jesus, the Jewish frame is indispensable. But this does not imply that those who want to follow Jesus have to become Jews themselves. Luke, and especially Acts, hint at a new Christian identity, Acts 11:26. To understand, however, how the Christians became who they are, the history or their history of origin has to be told. This indicates also a need for double hermeneutics. On the one hand, Jesus can only be understood adequately within the frame of the scriptures of Israel. On the other hand, the early Jesus followers can only be understood with reference to this frame. If one needs this frame of reference to be able to understand Jesus correctly, one also needs it to understand those who socialize as a community in memory of him. Thus, this frame has to be perceived as a foundation or a Grunddatum for understanding Jesus and as a foundation for self-understanding. This understanding is independent of the question whether one is located within this frame or not. This is precisely the question that Luke Acts is struggling with. How intense must the tie to this Jewish framework be if one is to become and remain a member of the communities in memory of him? History has shown that for Gentile newcomers, it became less and less important to stand within this Jewish cultural framework. The whole question of the mission to the Gentiles and its premises
already negotiated early in acts indicates this clearly. On the other hand, this cultural frame is preserved as an identity marker over against those who are tempted to regard it as irrelevant, as for instance Marcion would do. The discussion, with all implications, therefore still applies to us today. If it is no longer necessary to stand within this cultural frame in order to understand Jesus adequately, in what sense is this frame itself still needed? The recent discussion at the University of Berlin about the text of Notker Schlenska and his idea that Old Testament has, in fact, no longer canonical status is exactly about this problem. From a cultural studies and social memory point of view, the answer is it is still needed because it is embodied in the community's foundational texts. It is impossible to understand emerging Christianity without the scriptures of Israel. For that reason, they remain important, even for Gentile Christians. The point is not that one has to become Jewish in order to follow the way. In a related episode in Mark 7:37, the Gentile characters in the Decapolis, who marveled at how Jesus could open the ears and loosen the tongue of the handicapped man they had brought to him, remain Gentile, even though they praise God in the words of Isaiah 35. That means, when Luke Acts is regarded as the footprint of a community's collective memory, the scriptures in which the community lives and to which it refers in order to understand itself play a crucial role in its identity construction. The textualized authoritative tradition is the frame in which the community members understand themselves and from which their identity emerges. Thus, it is no surprise that this frame later became canonized and is still part of all Christian foundational texts or holy scriptures. When the two disciples return from Emmaus and reconvene with the Jerusalem group, they only have a chance to speak after the 11 and the other disciples have communicated their story. The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon. Their confession has often been regarded as a piece of tradition that was inserted into Luke's gospel. A memory-sensitive reading would see it differently. While Cleopas and his anonymous companion encountered Jesus, the Jerusalem group too have arrived at a stable narrative construct. From now on, everything that takes place and will take place is occurring because of Jesus' resurrection and his appearance to the principal witness, Peter. Most intriguingly, this element of the group's story, namely the appearance to Peter, is neither found in Luke nor described in the other canonical Gospels. On the basis of the other Gospels, the confession should read, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Mary." The third Gospel, however, names Peter as the guarantor and initial receiver of the revelation. Here, another memory is communicated in accordance with 1 Corinthians 15:4. The remark that Peter saw Jesus first, remark that Peter saw Jesus first and foremost reveals something about the group. Peter is the center and should also play an important role in the future. Membership in the Jerusalem memory group is not possible without accepting this story. With the word, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon," the group describes for newcomers the conditions for community. Anyone who does not accept both the resurrection of Jesus and Peter's testimony will not become a member of this group. The case of Peter, who is in none of the Gospels depicted as the first to encounter the risen Jesus, but in spite of his betrayal, remembered as the principal witness, is not only a good example for the tendency of memory texts to shape the past according to the needs of the present and the social reality of those who remember it, but also a solemn warning against the naive concept of memory and referentiality. The first glimpses into the way Luke tells the story of Jesus and the group of followers provided today clearly indicate that his diegesis is less about history than about tradition. The Lucan text itself leaves little doubt that the realization of the events it narrates cannot be perceived by historical argument. The addressed Theophilus, irrespectively of the decision whether he is regarded as a real person or a metaphorical reader construction, has to be seen as a Christian, at least familiar with Christian tradition, and as someone who will read and understand Luke Acts within this social-cultural frame. Reader communication in the Gospel fosters a mutual understanding of author and reader. The events which have been fulfilled in our midst and which are intrinsically linked to the history of Jesus are God's story. Christians are able to recognize and understand this history because the risen Jesus himself unlocked it to them, Luke 24. Thus, the starting point for Luke's hermeneutics are the appearances of the risen Jesus, occasions at which he opened up the disciples' minds to the scriptures and the proper way to understanding them. This indicates already that the Lucan text is more about interpretation than about the events themselves. The truth of the founding story is much more a social agreement than depicting past events. The reality construction, Wirklichkeitskonstruktion, shapes the past according to the needs of the present. Or as my favorite Swiss author Max Frisch would say, a man has made an experience and now he is looking for the story of his experience. Thank you very much.